Good evening, YouTube. This is André Boulay from YoYoExpert, and I'm here with Mark Montgomery tonight to talk about his new yo-yo, the OneDrop MarkMont CLASSIC. Say hello, Mark.
Hello.
All right. So I just wanted to kind of start off and get a quick introduction going with Mark in case you don't know who he is. He's quite the legend in yo-yoing. And he's had a couple yo-yos out with OneDrop, and this is by far his most exciting one yet. So go ahead and introduce yourself real quick, Mark. Tell us a little bit about you.
Yep. My name is Mark Montgomery. I've been yo-yoing since 2000. I learned the basics in 99. I've been on OneDrop yo-yos for quite some time. We've put out 3 yo-yos now. Let me think. Mark Mont next. William Marmont, MarkMont, and the MarkMont Classic. So I guess that's 4. A lot of people forget about the Woolly MarkMont because that was a collaborative yo-yo. But my name is still on it, so it still counts.
YouTube, this is André Boulay from YoYo. Oh,
is that on your side?
With Mark Montgomery tonight to talk about his new yo-yo. I think we had the stream up on the other side. Sorry about that.
No, I mean, that's about it. You know, I'm
awesome.
just a regular guy that likes to play with yo-yos and make tricks.
You're a regular guy.
That's me.
Well, what got you started? When did you first start? Looks like we might have lost Mark there. We'll check in with him in a minute. You there, Mark? So anyways, while we're waiting for Mark to kind of jump back into the chat here, we've gone ahead and collected a bunch of different questions from the forum that we will be posing to Mark. So we're definitely going to kind of get some questions answered from you guys. Looks like you might be back here. Did we lose you for a second? Great.
1 second. Good.
Okay, awesome. So I was saying, I'm not sure where you got cut off, but I was asking, when did you first get started in yo-yos?
Yeah, so I learned the basics in 99, and then I stopped for a while. Sorry, I learned the basics in 96, then I stopped for a few years and picked it back up again more seriously in 2000. I got back into it because my dorm advisor at the time, Mr. Bart Landenberger at the Eaglebrook School in Deerfield, he had a yo-yo collection, and he showed me a few advanced tricks because he knew how to do some stuff. And after I learned those tricks, that summer I was driving home with my mom from the school, and we stopped at A to Z Science and Learning in Northampton, which was one town over. And then Jack Finn.
It's a great store. That's where I got my start yo-yo into. Sorry to cut you off. Go ahead.
By all means. So, you know, I stopped at that store. He told me about, you know, the new age of yo-yos. Told me about the Y3A contest that summer. So then when I went home for that summer, saw some videos online of the spin docs out in California doing amazing tricks, and that's just when I got really hooked and just kept going with it.
Awesome. What we love hearing, like, the stories of how people got started, and it's cool. Like, you and me, actually, A to Z is where I got my start, too, and if I hadn't visited the store, I probably wouldn't be here, so it's kind of cool that we both have a similar background there. It's pretty neat.
Yes.
So when you first started learning, like, what inspired you or who inspired you the most in terms of tricks and everything? Like, where do you feel like your style of yo-yoing comes from, or is it all you, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite a few people. You know, I got to give a major shout out to Gabriel, a.k.a. Citadel from Sector Y. I got to give a big shout out to Glass Eye. You guys know him as Brian. Takeshi and Doc Pop. They were the main people putting out trick videos of the players. You know, if it wasn't for them putting out those videos, then I wouldn't have that base, you know, of tricks to learn from. But as far as the players, I would say Gary Longoria, Paul Escalar, again, Citadel, Jason Lee, Spencer Berry, Matt Rose for a time. Let's see, who else? Sage.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I haven't heard of him in a while, but definitely. Yeah, these are all a lot of the same names that come to mind, like, when I think about my beginning, too. So it's pretty awesome. Yeah, Gabe, for sure. Without Sector Y, I think the whole YoYo world would look a lot different. So he had quite an impact. So.
Yeah, and then a few others. Ant-Man. His name's Ant-Man. Yeah. Steve Brown.
Of course.
I forget if I said Doc Pop. And I think there was one other. Who was it? I can't think of the name. I'll come back to that. I think there's one other name.
Yeah, there's a lot of good players there, though. If anyone's curious, they should definitely Google some of those people or go to the Sector Y archive. That's a Google Sector Y YoYo archive. You'll see a lot of the old classic videos, and those names specifically are all throughout that. Awesome.
Two more. Kyle Nguyen.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Incredibly fast.
Extreme spin.
Yes. And... oh, man, I had one more. I lost it. Let's keep moving.
Okay. Let's keep going. Awesome. I was just curious, you know, as you've gone on, you've had some pretty amazing accomplishments in your YoYo career, and I was curious what you felt were the biggest or most important ones to you. You can just kind of – it might be a couple. It might just be one.
Yeah, I mean, the ones that stand out to me were probably – let's see. In the summer of 2001, I got first place in the freestyle and the compulsory division, at the Y3A contest, which is the Omega YoYo Association World Championship.
I was there for that one. I remember you winning.
Like, that one really sticks out because the year before, like, that was the first contest I went to, and I got like second to last place in the second to lowest division.
Wow.
So, you know, to come back 1 year later and get first, that was a really big deal. And then I came back again the year after that and got first again. So that, you know, I was concerned if I'd be able to do it again. But, you know, those were two moments that really stand out. Getting first place at, you know, Artistic Performance, I think it was the second year they did it at Worlds. You know, that felt really good, you know,
I think to me that definitely stands out the most, I think, because it was such a unique thing that you brought into YoYoing. Like, I think the Artistic Performance division was still very much kind of coming into its own. Mm-hmm. And if you go back and Google Mark's Artistic Performance, what year was it for Worlds?
I think it was 2003.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, if you go back and Google that, you'll see what he did. And yeah, the Artistic Performance division was kind of this, like, what is this division? We're not really sure. Some people are kind of just dancing around, and Mark really brought, like, a completely new element into it, so you should definitely go check out his video for sure. Actually, one of my favorite memories of you specifically is we were at one of the Omega contests, and you were the only player I've ever seen really do this, too. Like, your freestyle started, and you couldn't really do this now because of the rules, but the first thing you did is when you got off the stage and you shook all the judges' hands personally.
Yeah.
You went ahead and did your freestyle. But that was a pretty slick move.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Those days were like priceless. Those days, like, you can't get those days back. The rules are different. The skill level is like on 10,000, so there's this. Like, those were some fun days. Like, seriously, like, there would be players, including myself, that would go up on stage with maybe a list of, like, 10 to 20 different elements that we had been playing with. Not tricks, not even combos, but just elements.
Yep.
And then getting up on stage and literally being like, okay, let me mess with these elements and put together a freestyle. So you can't do that now because the caliber is too high. But back then, you know, that's how some players did it.
That's a good question. So would you say it was more difficult to compete back then, or is it more difficult to compete now?
Oh, what? It's way more difficult to compete now. Like,
I think it's good for people to hear. Like, I have so many people in my contest, like, asking, like, you know, when's the best time to start and stuff like that, or like, you know, how do you build a freestyle? It seems so difficult. And I think it's really good to hear someone who's come through the whole system all on the way. it's not easy. It takes a lot of time, and like, you know, you're not going to go and hit it perfect the first time you go and give it a shot.
Not at all. It's a lot more difficult now because, you know, yo-yos have improved. Players are coming in at different stages of trick dexterity. Like, tricks are incredible right now. Not that they weren't then, but right now, like, there's a lot of very, very technical and still flowing, you know, high quality tricks. There's a lot of originality coming out right now. Whereas, like, back then it was there, but it was like everybody was still trying to hit those tricks. Everybody was still trying to learn those tricks. Now it's like we're kind of back at this phase where people are taking everything that's out and mixing it in all together at the same time, fast. Like, I know, at least, I can name at least 20 different players that are, you know, for all intents and purposes, I would deem better than me as far as, like, just being able to just get up there and kill it. You know, I can kill it in different ways, stage presence and putting on a good performance and, you know, just, you know, doing what I do. But, you know, when I sit down and I look at it from a trick-to-trick basis, you know, there's just a lot of incredible players. The older you get, the less time you have to practice.
That's true.
I know that, you know, when they come in, they're coming in looking at the most ridiculous tricks now. You know, when I came in, I was looking at the most ridiculous tricks of 2000. So to look at the most ridiculous tricks of, you know, 2014 and have that as your starting point, you're already, you know, way ahead. So you're ramping up at a much faster pace, you know. So, you know, kids just, you know, you got a kid that looks at, you know, Zach Gormley. You know, I was looking at Jason Lee, you know. You got a kid that looks at Zach Gormley. You know, Zach Gormley's tricks are insanely technical, you know. There's plenty of players that are just, like, insane across the world. And when you have that pool to pull from, it's just massive. You know, you take your pick and you just keep going with it. You know, there's just so much more. It's difficult. It's a lot more difficult now. Good.
Yeah, it's good to hear that perspective. Again, like, I completely agree. I think the level of play is kind of, I mean, it's humbling to have seen where it's come from to today, because I think if someone had showed me, like, a video of, like, you know, someone like Zach 10 years ago, you know, you couldn't comprehend what they were going, the level of play that was going to be brought into yo-yo, and it's amazing. And it's a really cool thing to watch and continue to, just continues to evolve, so it's awesome. Great. So let's kind of jump into what we're really here to talk to you about, which I think a lot of people are interested in, is the MarkMont Classic, your new signature yo-yo. I'm going to throw out a couple questions, actually, that we got from the forums real quick, and then I'll go into my own questions. People right away wanted to know, this comes from Dirty Birdie on the forum, what made you decide to go for a round shape for the Classic? Because if people have seen the yo-yos that Mark's designed with OneDrop previously, it was not round. And actually, to continue that, there's a user that's called YoYo on the forum that wanted to know why you went with a full-size model. So maybe you can kind of give us some insight there.
Yeah, so there's a few different reasons. One, this yo-yo was my interpretation of the Classic butterfly shape that was, you know, popularized by Duncan. So in keeping with that concept, that's, you know, why the yo-yo came out the way it did. You know, the original MarkMont project was just a shape that was comfortable and its own thing. You know, that if and when I make the MarkMont 2, it'll, you know, if I add that 2 to MarkMont, then it's like that nomenclature stands in that same concept. So the design system will stay in that same world. But being that the concept was to take my interpretation of the butterfly and reinvent it, or, you know, kind of expand upon it, not reinvent it. You can't reinvent the butterfly shape. You just can't. You can only make improvements to it or make changes that you prefer to it. So that's why I went with, you know, that's why the yo-yo itself, you know, looks quote unquote round. As far as going up to full size, that's just been you know, natural progression. You know, when I started out, I was using Renegades, and those were, you know, small. And then when the Freehand 1 came onto the game, that was like, from a ratio standpoint, that was like the biggest you know, 1A trick yo-yo. It was wide and, you know, short, and it felt like, you were like, man, this thing's kind of big. I don't know, but it's amazing. And that's kind of the same effect that I wanted people to get when using this yo-yo. I wanted them to be like, whoa, this thing, you know, it feels kind of big and it's wide, but I like this. That's the same sentiment that I wanted people to get when they first threw this yo-yo.
It's true. I mean, this is definitely, it's what hits me immediately. That's funny that you said that, because, like, I couldn't quite articulate what it was, but you're right. You immediately get in your hand, and it feels big. And, I mean, it is, it's, the modern-day yo-yo has funny, because for a while, everybody wanted undersized. That's all they wanted. And it jumped back to full size, I think, after John Ando won Worlds. Ever since then, everyone's kind of went back to full size. And this, though, this just feels, it feels right. It does feel big, but as soon as you throw it, it just feels perfect. Captured what you wanted, I think. You articulated it far better than I did, so.
Yeah, I mean, like, I was comfortable using undersized. Well, it's weird calling it undersized because to me, like, normal size was a renegade. So, you know, my project, was, you know, for all intents and purposes, that was oversized. But at any rate, we'll go with that nomenclature. I was cool with undersized, but oversized, which is really not that much bigger when you get down to, you know, the millimeters and whatnot. But full size and over, you can do more with the design of the yo-yo. You get a different play. You get a different sense of balance, a different sense of stability with, you know, you get to play with the weight distribution better. And ultimately, it just felt, you know, as my tricks progressed and my style progressed, you know, a bigger yo-yo felt like, you know, the way I wanted to go with this. And, you know, that's just the direction we went with.
That's actually good. I kind of wanted to jump off that point then, actually. So you mentioned with a larger yo-yo, so you can actually, like, kind of choose where the weight is put, obviously, a little bit better because you have more room to play with. So, like, what was the design process for this, actually? Like, how long did it take? Was it easy? Was it hard? I mean, it's funny because you look at it, and it is. You're right. This is the classic butterfly shape, but we know that it's not as simple as just saying, hey, make this shape and go do it. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, I can. Okay, so for all intents and purposes, you know, this is relevant to what I've been doing lately with my apartment. If you look up lamps and you try to find a nice modern lamp, basically a lamp that looks simple and clean, base price will run you around $500. That's because being simple comes at a cost. To take the most complex concept or the most complicated design or idea and whittle it down to the simplest solution is incredibly difficult. Now, David and Sean are very talented. You know, I love working with those guys. And, you know, right off the bat, I told them, like, three different things that I wanted to hit on, and they nailed it. You know what I mean? We had a few different prototypes, and, you know, it was pretty much right there. It was 99% there. And then that last 1% is those details. You know, how sharp did we want the transition from the outer fit, you know, from the outer rim into the flat face? How sharp did we want that to get? How wide did we want that rim to look optically? You know, where we wanted that weight to sit? Do we want the weight to go more in the catch zone or more on the rims? Like, I'm telling you, if you move even a half a gram on each rim slightly in, it exponentially changes the play. Like, those minute differences make such a big difference. And finding out what that perfect balance was tricky, because you also have to take into account the reason why I was so content with the MarkMont project and the MarkMont Next being nickel is that those yo-yos, you know, were played great, but also had a reason for having that finish. That finish added weight, so, you know, the weight was perfect with that finish. You know what I mean? If when we did Anno, you could tell that the yo-yo plays different. It still plays good, but it plays different than the nickel. So with this one, being that we decided to do, you know, anodized and nickel, we had to find that sweet spot, you know, to where it would still play very good in Anno and still play very good in nickel, and both would be, like, you know, on the same level.
So, and it does, actually. I mean, again, when we had them in person at Nationals, and I saw people coming up and trying both of them in person, and they both play great. I think it's actually a hard choice which one to go for there.
Yeah. It's like, that's not a choice, you know, that's not a choice you should make. You should pretty much cave and buy
both. Yeah.
For all kinds of purposes, like, you're going to get, you know, something different. It's like the difference between buying, like, a nice pair of white sneakers, all white, or a nice pair of all black sneakers. They're like, they both have their merit, and they both have their outfits, but, you know, they give a different flair. So you really need to get both.
All right. Well, and so with that said, somebody on the forums, I believe, let's see, it is Zort Commander, would like to know, what's your favorite color of the classic, Mark?
I like them all.
Good answer.
The colors we put out are all colors that I picked. You know,
yep.
I'm not gonna make it that easy for you. You have to, you know, pick the color that you like. I like them all. I have them all. So, you know, just get them. Get them all. Figure it out. You know, don't get that extra video game this month. You know, use that money and go get you another color.
So. One of the other cool things I wanted to point out that we didn't touch on yet is the side effects in the yo-yo. They're new, and they remind me of another yo-yo. So can you mention a little bit about that?
Yes. So the side effects are, you know, as you probably guessed, based heavily off of the nuts that are on the MarkMont Next, and that was, you know, it was all by design. You know, we wanted it to have. I wanted to have certain elements from the MarkMont Next go into this. But not only that, there's certain design sensibilities or certain design details that I like, both from a aesthetic standpoint and from a play standpoint. You know, I like the weight that brass brings to the center. You know, I like the weight that I like how it makes the yo-yo play. And another one is the flat face on the outside. Like, that to me gives more comfort. If it was, you know, round up and then round all the way into the rims, to me that's not as comfortable in hand. It would also make the yo-yo feel a lot bigger than it is. So, you know, that's why, you know, I like how it looks.
Yeah, I should point out too, so like he said, the sock ones come with brass side effects.
Yeah.
And then you actually, which I thought was awesome, you've included aluminum ones here.
Yes.
With all of them. There's this little character guy.
Yes.
You want to say anything about the character? I think people love it.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if you... Okay, so the idea with that was, you know, I'm heavily basing the concept off of, you know, classic. And my interpretation of the butterfly. So I really wanted to, you know, make it feel like Duncan. You know, make it feel like Duncan. Let me get more specific. Duncan had a professional trick book, and on the cover there was a character that was throwing a yo-yo, and that was the first trick book I bought. And that image always stuck with me. It was like this, like, staple illustration. So. That was where I based the idea off of, you know, the gesture of the face. And on the, if you look on the collector's edition, you know, there's an illustration of me throwing the yo-yo. I'm kind of like this, and I'm smiling. And that was kind of, you know, the direction that I chose to go with the design, you know, based off of, you know, riffing off of what Duncan did and why, you know, and why I, you know, chose to go in that direction. It started out with it supposed to be being a version of me when I was like 14, but I just thought it was kind of weird to make a face of me looking 14, because it's almost like with 3D animation, if something looks so close to real, like the movie Beowulf, they use a technique called motion capture, where they get in the big suit of all these buttons, and then, you know, they use that and they make the animation and they make the movie out of that, or they make the animation out of that. When an animation looks so close to being real, but it's not quite, it's like 99.9%, then you automatically compare it to being real. So then it will never look right. It'll always look slightly off because it's not literally real. So for me, when I had an illustration done of me as 14, since it looked so close to me, but not quite right, it gave me that same kind of feeling. So I was like, you know, forget that. I'll do an interpretation of me, you know, when I had an afro. So you know, it seemed to make sense with the, you know, with the time period that illustration, the original illustration was done by Duncan. So, you know, put the afro on, put a little cheesy grin, and, you know, there we go.
So, and then also I wanted to mention real quick about the collector's edition and the very special artwork inside. If you guys haven't already seen it, you can check out Paul Dane's unboxing video to see everything that comes in the collector's edition. We'll also have it on the MarkMont Classic page. But that was incredible. How did that all come together? Because this is a lot of the things you were throwing out to hype up the product, and then the book itself like blew me away. It's one of the coolest things I've seen in terms of yo-yo art.
Oh man, you know what's so funny? I completely forgot about that book. I was like, are you talking about the buttons? I forgot about that.
The best part about the collector set.
you know, I'll be surprised if those don't sell out fast. And if they don't, I might be tempted to buy the rest myself because I was that happy with it. And
it's really special. I mean, if you guys haven't seen it, it's a flip book, and it's illustrations of a trick, and it's just one of the coolest things I've seen. You have to check out the video if you haven't seen it. But
yeah, so
it was a really unique idea.
So. Just to specify, it's a flip book both directions. So if you flip one way, you can flip in some much better. It's no trick. And then there's an illustration of each yo-yo that was kind of referenced in going into the Pokemon Classic.
Right. There's more to it than just the flip book. I was just totally amazed by the actual flip book part itself. So it's awesome.
A lot of work.
I can tell it's a lot of work. Awesome. Great job. Anyone who picks one up is going to kind of be blown away by how special it is, I think. And they didn't make many of them either, I think, from what I understand. It was a pretty limited run. So
100. Very
cool. Yeah, thanks for thinking out of the box. You know, it's cool to see people approach yo-yoing in different ways, and I always love to see an artist's approach to things. And you can really tell, like, this is probably one of the most thought-out designs in terms of every angle. It's very impressive.
Thank you.
So we're running out of time. I just gonna throw a few more kind of quick questions at you. So maybe you can kind of give me quick answers, I guess. I don't know if this is a quick answer question, but someone on the forum, EK Iaminator, wants to know, how do you come up with tricks? That's a tough one in 5 seconds, right?
basically, I just throw. You know, I throw and I see what elements come up. You know, I might have an idea of a certain direction or a certain motion that I want the trick to feel like, and then I'll start riffing off of that, like with the more, like when you see my, like, trapeze-type tricks where, like, I'll, like, throw it up and do, like, laceration. Like, those are, like, this concept or ideas that come to mind. But my combos and my tricks are a combination of, you know, me messing around and just so happen to be getting into a cool element and to start, you know, branching off from that. Or looking at elements that are like from other people's tricks and seeing how I can take my own spin on them. That's the short answer.
Awesome. No, that's great. That's great. Do you have any favorite? I mean, I know we're talking about OneDrop dominantly here, but it came up a couple times, so I figured I'd throw it out there. Do you have a non-OneDrop favorite yo-yo? It could be a classic one or whatever. They also wanted to give you a shout out and mention that your Dragon screen is awesome.
Thank you.
Include that in too. That's 888 Victini on the forums. But yeah, what's your give us some favorites?
I would say I like a lot of the CLYW products. I'm a big fan of the Yeti, big fan of the Chief. I forget what the name of his next yo-yo is, because I'm not sure if it's out yet, but whatever his next yo-yo is, I'm really big fan of that.
The Scout.
Plays really good. It's awesome. Solid. And the Antio Goontosh, which isn't out yet. I think if you said if we can get 1,000 people to send them an email saying that we want that, and it'll finally come out.
We'll start a petition. Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll just end real quick. I want to thank you for taking the time out of your night to kind of join us and talk about the design process and everything. It was great. And from here, what's next? Where are you, what direction are you moving in with yo-yo? And I think somebody wanted to know if you might compete ever again, or is art, or is, you know, is yo-yoing just your art now? How you express yourself, or like I guess in terms of yo-yoing, like what do you see next for yourself?
Okay, so let me try to wrap this up in like really quick. But
yeah,
competing, yes, I will compete again. You young whippersnappers are incredible, so I gotta make sure I come correct.
Wow, this is exciting. You heard it here first. I love it.
It's gonna take me a minute before I can, you know, clear out everything and designate the amount of hours and months that it takes for me to finish my material. You know, I got elements I've been working on for, you know, years that have just been sitting, you know, not consecutively, like, they've just been sitting, and I just haven't had the time to finish them. Anyway, there's that. I will compete.
Exciting.
What else? As far as what's next for me in yo-yoing, so I'm really big on emceeing. Me and my friends run a freestyle rap cypher event and community outreach initiative called Soul Food Cypher. Please check that out, soulfoodcypher.com. You can see all about that.
I'll add a link on the YouTube page too. So
yeah. So with that, I'm pretty much the resident MC or the resident host. And with, you know, after doing that for a while, and also another big moment that was pivotal in my yo-yo career was being on tour for Hasbro, doing shows for the Fast 201, and I got a good chance to be an MC in that framework for 3 months. But doing that and between doing that tour and doing what I do for Soul Food Cypher as a host, like I really like hosting. I like entertaining. This past summer, I was at the Duncan International Yo-Yo Opening with Brett Uchkunis, and me and him co-hosted that contest. So hopefully you see me doing more hosting. I started judging. I judged Northeast Regionals this year with André. Thank you for having me come out. You know, that was a blast. It was me, you know, see me doing that more. You know, I'll keep making yo-yos as that comes. And outside of that, you know, I'm a designer. So, and I'm an art director by title, but a designer by craft. And,
yeah, I was going to say that came across when you were given the Beowulf reference. I was like, this is totally the graphic artist and Mark and the animator coming right out. It's awesome. You can hear that you're quite the pro. So,
thank great. You. I mean, but just to wrap it up in a nutshell, I just try to do whatever interests me. You know, my mom plays the piano. I want to learn how to play the piano. I've always wanted to learn how to play the drums. I'm going to do that. I do freestyle house dance. I do a lot of stuff. I just do whatever, you know, interests me. Lately I've been into interior design and redecorating my apartment. That Amazing. Sounds a little small, but that's all good.
Love
I guess
it.
Sometimes I want to be comfortable, you know, my hair is soft.
That's great. Well, thank you again. This was awesome to get a chance to talk to you and kind of learn a little bit about the yo-yo. It's a MarkMont Classic. This is going to be up on a countdown on YoYoExpert tomorrow. It releases tomorrow at midnight. Ooh. And we've got a bunch of standard editions, as well as the collector's edition, a bunch of different colors, as well as the nickel. It's a great, excellent yo-yo. I picked one up at Nationals, and I haven't put it down. You can just tell there's a lot of love here. So, great job, Mark. Thank you.
Definitely thank you for having
me. Awesome. Great. Thank you to you, and thank you to OneDrop too for working to make such a great design and bring this out to the world of yo-yos. It's great. Awesome. Well, have a great night, and good night to everyone on YouTube.